For decades, Americans speculated about the Soviet moon program. But no one had grasped just how close they had come to putting a man on the moon until late 1991, when the USSR suddenly collapsed. As millions of top-secret documents became public, so did the details of the N1 rocket, a Soviet marvel of engineering designed to rival NASA's Saturn V and perhaps even dwarf it. Where the Americans relied on 5 engines for their lunar ambitions, Soviets had crammed 30 kerosene-burning closed-cycle engines into a single launch vehicle. 30. The daring gamble promised to crown the Soviets in the space race. But power like that comes at a cost. The uncovered documents told a chilling story of hubris, miscalculation, and an unprecedented catastrophe. A single misstep turned the dream of Soviet lunar dominance into a nightmare, one that unleashed the largest non-nuclear explosion in human history. And it was captured on video. The N1 rocket towered over the Kazakh steppe like a white Gothic cathedral, a 105-meter monument to Soviet ambition. It was the USSR's attempt to put a cosmonaut on the moon at any cost. Weighing an astounding 2,750 metric tons, it was the largest rocket the Soviets ever attempted to launch. Its unique structure resulted from both their ingenuity and the constraints of their era. The rocket's 3-stage design was unlike anything in the West. Open truss structures and spherical fuel tanks gave it its unique silhouette, an engineering necessity born from the Soviet inability to produce the large, lightweight tank systems used in the American Saturn V. Similarly, Soviet industry couldn't manufacture the massive combustion chambers or turbopumps needed for massive engines like the Saturn V's mighty F1s. Instead, the solution was sheer quantity. Cluster dozens of smaller engines together to generate the required thrust as quickly as possible. And so, the N1 was a gamble on numbers. Its first stage featured a staggering 30 NK-15 engines, each producing 153 metric tons of thrust, arranged in 2 concentric rings, 24 on the outer edge and 6 at the center for roll control. The second stage relied on 8 engines, the third on 4, and the fourth on 1. The NK-15s were a technical marvel in theory, designed by Nikolai Kuznetsov's bureau, employing an advanced closed-cycle design that promised exceptional efficiency. On paper, this engine cluster would make the N1 the most powerful rocket ever built. But theory and reality don't always agree. The decision to pack so many engines into one rocket unleashed a cascade of engineering challenges. Synchronizing 30 engines required the perfect assembly of tens of thousands of sensors, controllers, and plumbing arrays. A system so complex, it drastically multiplied the chances of failure. Compounding this was the rudimentary state of Soviet computing in the 1960s. One misfire could trigger a catastrophic chain reaction. Alexei Leonov, the Soviet cosmonaut slated to command the first lunar mission and the first man in history to do a spacewalk, remarked, quote, "The chance of the first mission returning safely was only 50-50. Even this assessment was optimistic. With such a precarious setup, disaster was not just likely, it was inevitable. Instead of marking the Soviet Union's glorious entry into the lunar race, the first launch of the N1 rocket, named the 3L, started a tragic chain of disasters. On February 21, 1969, the N1 roared to life, its 30 NK-15 engines igniting simultaneously and pushing the colossal rocket skyward. For 68.7 seconds, it climbed through the cold Kazakh sky with surprising ease, leaving behind a searing torch of exhaust fire. Then, disaster struck. Debris lodged in the fuel system of Engine 2 sparked a fire that spread rapidly through the first stage. The automatic cord system, created by Vasily Pavlovich Mishin, the director of the N1 program, shut down all the engines. And just over a minute after liftoff, the N1 was obliterated by range safety. What should have been the dawn of a new era was reduced to a trail of fire and debris streaking back to Earth. The Soviets refused to give up. The second launch, designated 5L, was meant to redeem the program. Instead, it became the most catastrophic failure in the N1's short, troubled history, and its most infamous. On July 3, 1969, as the world awaited Apollo 11's historic launch, the Soviet Union prepared to make its own bold move. At Baikonur, the N1 once again began its countdown. Its engine spewed white fire as it lifted off. For a second, victory seemed within reach. But the triumph was short-lived. a single loose bolt dislodged within the oxidizer system was sucked into an oxygen pump. The result was catastrophic. Engine 8 exploded, triggering a chain reaction that tore through the rocket. A searing flash lit up the night sky as engines failed in succession, save one, Engine 18, which burned helplessly as the rocket spiraled out of control. Seconds later, the N1 plummeted back to Earth, striking the launch pad with devastating force. The impact ignited 2,300 tons of propellant, unleashing an explosion equivalent to 7 kilotons of TNT. It was the largest non-nuclear explosion in human history, a blast so powerful that it shattered windows dozens of kilometers away, rained fire across the Kazakh steppe, and reduced Baikonur's primary launch pad to smoldering ruins. The world watched in horror and fascination. American reconnaissance satellites captured the explosion's aftermath, though its exact cause remained a mystery to them. The devastation could have been even worse. If the RP-1 kerosene fuel and liquid oxygen had mixed, they would have formed a volatile gel, magnifying the explosion to even more apocalyptic levels. Thankfully, that nightmare was avoided. Weeks later, Apollo 11 would land men on the moon. The Soviets, meanwhile, faced an 18-month setback and the smoldering ruins of their lunar ambitions. The dream of Soviet dominance had been incinerated over the Kazakh desert. With the triumph of the Apollo 11 mission, the Soviet Union faced mounting pressure to prove its own capabilities. After all, they'd been the first nation to put a man in space. They had a significant lead. There was no reason for the USSR to fall behind so close to the finish line. Rebuilding the launch pad took 18 months, a painstaking effort that revealed kerosene-based propellant's destructive capabilities. 2 years after the July 1969 explosion, the Soviets rolled out the third N1 rocket, designated 6L. Significant improvements had been made to cord, such as the cabling and fuel pumps, and an extinguishing system and filters were added. Engineers installed fuel filters to prevent debris contamination, painted the rocket white to reduce internal temperatures, and enhanced ventilation systems. Optimism ran high, but fundamental flaws still lurked beneath the surface. On June 26, 1971, 6L lifted off, its 30 engines roaring again. For 50 seconds, success seemed possible. Then, interaction between the engine's exhaust gases caused the rocket to spin uncontrollably. The range safety officer, watching helplessly as the behemoth spiraled into chaos, issued the order for destruction. The resulting explosion lit the Kazakh desert yet again, an all-too-familiar sight for the battered program. The Soviets pressed forward. In November 1972, they made one final attempt with 7L. This time, the first stage performed better than its predecessors, carrying the N1 farther than ever before. But at 107 seconds, turbulence in the fuel lines ruptured Engine 4, igniting a fire that consumed the rocket. The N1 traveled 125 kilometers downrange before disintegrating. Each fiery disaster was cloaked in secrecy. Even as Apollo missions returned lunar samples and pushed the boundaries of space exploration, the Soviets maintained a facade of competence. But within the corridors of Baikonur, there was no escaping the truth. The N1 was a magnificent failure. By 1973, the Soviet dream of a lunar landing had crumbled. The N1 program, once hailed as a bold leap forward, was quietly abandoned. Valentin Glushko, now in charge of the nation's rocket program, declared the N1 a failure and ordered every blueprint, component, and assembly destroyed. Soviet leadership erased the project from public memory, denying the USSR had ever pursued a lunar program. For decades, the N1 project was aggressively buried beneath layers of Soviet bureaucracy. The fall of the Soviet Union in 1991 finally brought the story to light. As archives opened, the full extent of the N1's ambition and failure came to light. Declassified documents and Mishin's personal diaries revealed a program pushed by ambition and nationalism, yet shackled by devastating bureaucracy and budget constraints. To many of his critics, Mishin's poor administrative abilities and severe alcohol problems were also pivotal in the failures of the N1 initiative. Project engineers never questioned Mishin's remarkable rocket genius, and they firmly believed the fifth launch would surely have succeeded if it had only been given a chance. But it was too late. The Americans had reached the moon and left their footprints on its surface, rendering Soviet efforts obsolete. cost of the N1 program was a mind-bending $11 billion, equivalent to nearly half the Apollo program's total $24 billion budget. Yet while Apollo resulted in 12 astronauts walking on the moon and nearly 400 kilograms of lunar samples brought back to Earth in a revolutionary scientific breakthrough, the N1 program achieved nothing but craters in the Kazakh desert. The financial strain that those $11 billion put on the Soviet economy was immense, and it was another pharaonic project that put ambition over practicality and even the people's well-being. Today, the remains of the N1 rocket linger as pieces of a broken dream. Abandoned sections of the rocket serve as storage sheds or gazebos, rusting in the Kazakh steppe. All that's left of the engineering marvel that was doomed by bureaucracy, secrecy, and haste.